check the room carefully to spot it.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you managed to do what you wanted to do here in Hofgut Sternen, beautifully situated here in the Black Forest, as you can see. And we'll cast one last glance at the viaduct there to our right. And in front of that viaduct, that hill on which a pavilion stands, I'll tell you a little more about that in just a little while. But the next building I'd like to draw your attention to is ahead of us on the right-hand side. A little way up the hill, you see it, the old church of St. Oswald's, the oldest church in the Black Forest, over 850 years old. Interesting, you know, had you paid a visit, you would have been able to look down into the cellars below, and what would you have found? You'd have found piles of human bones. And people wonder, what are those human bones doing in the cellar of the church? Well, you know, the fact of the matter is, in the old days, those old churches, they would have been surrounded by a graveyard. They wouldn't have resembled any graveyards that we know of today. There would have been no gravestones, but people used to bury their dead in what they considered to be hallowed ground around the churches. Every now and again, of course, they used to get so full of bones that they had to disinter some of the old bones in order to make room for new old bones. And those disinterred bones, they were stored in the cellar of the church. Bigger churches, they would have had their own chapels for that very purpose, called grand chapels or ossuaries, and that's the way they used to do things in the old days. Now, had you walked to that church, you would have had to pass a toll booth on the way there, because we would have had to pay to travel along this road. And just next to that toll booth, you know, there's a milestone which announces that Freiburg is 3 hours away from here. Well, that was in the days of horseback riding. We expect to do it in about 20 minutes for you today, but in the old days it would have taken 3 hours to get from here to Freiburg. Now, back to the hotel, at the hill in front of the hotel there, or behind the hotel rather, crowned with a pavilion these days, in the old days, but there was another structure to be found on top of that hill, because from the 16th century onwards, the innkeeper there, he used to hold court cases in the hotel itself. And the unfortunate ones, you know, they had to take their last little walk up the hill, because on top of that hill, that's where you would have found the gallows. And the last person to be hung there was in 1758, apparently. Now that we find ourselves in a part of the Black Forest which is known as the Höllental. In English, the Valley of Hell. Now, why is they call it the Valley of Hell? Well, you remember I told you how important this road was as a part of the main trade route between Vienna and Paris, and all of these rich merchants travelling up and down here regularly. Well, the further down we go now, you'll find that the rocks on either side of the road will get closer and closer together. They'll reach high into the sky, and they do form a gorge, which we will have to pass through. Now then, in the old days, it was rather dangerous because it presented a perfect opportunity for the local highway robbers and bandits, you see, to hold up these rich, these carriages full of rich merchants and VIPs, and they'd relieve the passengers of their purses, of their money, and it was so dangerous. They called it the Valley of Hell, the Höllental. Now look to the right here, you'll see an old disused railway station called Hirschsprung. Now Hirschsprung in English, the Stag's Leap, refers to another legend concerning this part of our journey, the legend of the stag, who was pursued by a hunter. He managed to elude this hunter for a period of time, but unfortunately, eventually the stag was cornered on the rock on the left-hand side of the road as we go down here now, and its only means of escape was to leap from the rock on the left-hand side of the road onto the rock on the right-hand side of the road. And of course, the stag achieved that task and managed to escape the hunter in that way. And ever since, they erected a monument, a statue to commemorate the Stag's Leap. And you can see it very shortly, high up on the rock on the left-hand side of the road. As we go around this bend now, look out for it, look out for it, look out there. There it is, the stag up there on top of the rock on the left-hand side of the road. Can you see it? A noble creature indeed. It was originally carved in wood, later on cast in bronze. Now somebody's gone and painted it white. I preferred it in its original state. I hope it will be restored to its original state as soon as possible. I realize, though. Good, we will be accompanied by the railway line up there, high on the right-hand side. Oh, the same railway line which travels the viaduct there will accompany us down to the village of Himmelreich, and we'll get there in 5 minutes or so. Lord Falkensteig, the rise of the falcon. And just below that sign, you might have noticed another sign. It said radar. I think it needs no translation. It means, of course, that drivers who drive through here, they have to keep to the speed limit, which is 50 kilometers an hour, 30 miles an hour or so. And, of course, if they don't keep to the speed limit, they're liable to have their picture taken, you see. And after 2 or 3 weeks, they'll send them that picture and a fine for 50 euros. I know. And the worst thing, they don't even give you a chance to smile for the picture. Terribly thoughtless of him, but that's the way they are. But there is a story about this, of course. You know, a fellow drives through one of these villages, he totally ignores the radar sign, he totally ignores the speed limit, and shamefully, he exceeds the speed limit. And of course, he has his picture taken. And after 2 or 3 weeks, they send him that picture and a fine for 50 euros. So what does he do? He takes a picture of a 50 Italy after. It's called Himmelreich. In English, the realm of the heavens. Now, why should they call it the realm of the heavens? Well, you can imagine these rich merchants, having survived the valley of hell, they'd come to these wide open spaces here, and they'd say, we're at the realm of the heavens. So they call this next village Himmelreich. There's a hotel directly ahead of us, the green building towards the right. Is there a railway station? There's a little factory in the background. A field of flowers, a few houses dotted around, and that's it. The little hamlet of Himmelreich. Skiing along the highest slopes, for instance. Numerous toboggan runs can be found up there. The lakes of the Black Forest, as soon as the ice is thick enough, they become outdoor skating arenas. But if you ask the people of the Black Forest what they enjoy more than anything else about the winters around here, I'm sure that most of them would reply, cross-country skiing. They do love their cross-country skiing, and what happens, you see, is as soon as the first snows fall, a machine will draw out the tracks for the ice hockey. There's an ice hockey stadium in Freiburg. Indoor sports include volleyball, basketball, and handball. But you know the sport with which the Germans identify themselves more than any other? It is, of course, soccer. They do love their soccer. And we're shortly going to enter some tunnels now. These tunnels will speed our path into the city of Freiburg, below the outlying suburbs of Kappel and Littenweiler. And it is in Littenweiler, that's where you'll find the local soccer stadium. And they're very proud. Freiburg has made its way back into the Bundesliga, the main German soccer league. And they'll be back there next season. Of course, everybody in Germany these days, they have their eyes glued to the TV set, their TV sets every night, watching, because the European Championships are taking place now, the soccer championships, and of course, before any of these, all of these competitions, you know, the Germans have high hopes of winning, of course, in fact, the last one was too celebrating today. In the summer, you know, in the Black Forest, you'll find lots of cyclists in the Black Forest. The hills of the Black Forest are ideal conditions to practice for the mountains of the Tour de France, which is the main cycling event of the year here in Europe. And it'll start next weekend, I believe, next Saturday. So they love to go cycling in the Black Forest as well. And what do the Germans like to eat? well. They have expert beers, they have wheat beers, they have a clear wheat beer, they also have a yeast wheat beer, where the yeast forms a sediment in the bottle, actually ferments within the bottle. You have to be sure to shake the yeast into your glass to have the full benefits of your yeast wheat beer. They have regional beers, every region has its own beers, they have festival beers for different times of year. And here we emerge into the sunny city of Freiburg. And talking about beer, the first significant building which we come across is this one, and it's on the right-hand side. It is the Brauerei Gante, the main brewery around here. And you see, when we go further down, you can look into the courtyard within, and you can see what a big array of buildings it is. Tens of thousands of liters of beer will be brewed here every day for thirsty Germans, and this is just one brewery amongst many others dotted around the countryside. And have a look there on the right hand side now, you'll see where it is. Tram lines on the left hand side of us. We continue. No congestion today. Look ahead of us, you see the top of the tower of the eastern gate of the city, the Swabian gate of the city, and just to the right of that, you might just catch a glimpse of the top of the spire of the cathedral, covered in scaffolding, and I'll come back to that later. The river which we have to cross, this is the Dreisam River, which gathers up all those streams from the Black Forest, carries them down eventually down to the Rhine River, and we are going to make it through these green lights, I believe. And when we do, look to the right, and you see the outer facade of the eastern gate of the city. Ah, we won't make it this time, which is good. I can talk to you about some other things. The two spires, by the way, ahead of us there on the left-hand side, those are the two spires of St. John's Church, the Johanneskirche, Freiburg's second church. You see the tram, the streetcar, crossing our path here, which accounts for much of the congestion along this street here. The public transport vehicles cross our path at two separate points, and but they won't keep us back too long today. There's a ticket, actually, that you can buy. They call it the environmental ticket, 50 euros. It enables you to, entitles you to ride on all the public transport vehicles, the buses, the trains, and the trams. And it's meant to dissuade everybody from using their own vehicles, but it doesn't always work. Be prepared to look to the right, and you'll see the outer facade of the Swabian Gate. You might just see a portrait of St. George there as well, because St. George is not only the patron saint of England, but also the patron saint of Freiburg. Look ahead of us on the right-hand side of the road, you can see there's a psychopath. Sorry, did I say psychopath? Sorry, I meant a cycle path, of course. It's a bicycle path. You see, Freiburg is a city of 230,000 individuals, 30,000 of whom are students who attend the local university here. Very old and famous university, the Albert Ludwigs University, founded in 1457. And those students, their favorite mode of transport is the bicycle. And they are well catered for here, not only the students, but also the other cyclists, and not only in the cities, but also in surrounding countryside to the city. St. Martin's Gate to the city, it's quite an impressive structure, and it will come into view very shortly on the right-hand side of the road. No, there it is. St. Martin's Gate to the city. There were originally five gates to the city. Two of them remain, and we've caught a glimpse of both of them. They were both built during the first half of the 13th century. Good. The university, the main faculties, law, medicine, natural sciences, computer sciences, and electronics these days as well. They study the humanities. There's a state music college to be found in Freiburg, and also a teacher training college, and it attracts 30,000 to the city every year. And we've yet to talk about the cathedral, which dominates the city of Freiburg. It was the first stones were laid around 1200. It was originally designed according to the Romanesque cathedral of Basel. Later on, work was continued along Gothic lines, as was often the case. The Western Spire, it was completed in 1330. And it was crowned with open stonework, with filigree stonework, which was quite unique at the time. It was also the highest spire in Christendom for 3 years, anyway, before it was overtaken by some others, other churches. The old Romanesque chancel was demolished in the 15th century, and work was started on a new Gothic chancel, which was eventually consecrated in 1513. Now, what I'm getting at is that cathedral was built of red sandstone from the Black Forest Mountains. Red sandstone, and as any stonemason will tell you, it's a wonderful material to work with, soft and malleable, but it is also vulnerable, especially to pollution and acid rain. And you saw the scaffolding on the spire there. The Cathedral Masons Guild, these are the men and the women as well, who are constantly at work restoring some of the stonework of the cathedral there. You know, they reckon that there'll never be a time in future when that cathedral is not at least partially covered in scaffolding, because as soon as they finished work, was an excellent idea. He thought it would be beneficial for the inhabitants of the cities of Germany, you know, to be able to escape from the smoke and the noise and the general pollution of the city and breathe some fresh air. You know. And of course, everybody took him up on this, and they took one of these gardens. These days, there's not enough of these gardens to go around, but 40% of the inhabitants of Freiburg, they do rent one of these gardens today. They're very much in demand, and they're also very strict. You're going to see some more of them very shortly. On the right-hand side, there, you see those gardens there on the right-hand side? And they're very strict here in Germany, of course, you know. You can do it in the 13th century, still there today, 8.5 miles of them altogether, and they were put to many uses. Originally, they were used for washing clothes, for watering livestock, but their main purpose was to enable the inhabitants of Freiburg to put out any fires which might have broken out in the city itself. And it's significant, you know, that all through the Middle Ages there were no great fires in Freiburg at all, and at least not until the Second World War. And you can put that down to some extent on the constant presence of water supplied by these little streams of water running through the city. These days they don't use them so often for putting out fires, but they certainly add a lot of charm to the city of Freiburg, these trickling streams of water running all the way through the old city there in Freiburg. Autobahn once again, and this time we'll be travelling in a southerly direction for a little while before turning off and heading towards Breisach, and hopefully your ship will be waiting for us. Yes, I think maybe this might be a good opportunity for us to have one last look at these maps, these rather extraordinary maps that are classed to most of we've come along. Whereas in the Kaiser Street,
this is the Autobahn.
White wine, which they grow here in the Thunberg, is mostly red wine. But it doesn't really matter. Red wine, white wine, these grapes, they're hand harvested in September and October. The vineyards are family owned. And for the wine harvest, you know, there's so much work to be done. It's far too much work for the local population. And they need help from abroad, and traditionally it comes from Poland. Although these days they come from other parts of Eastern Europe as well. They'll come over in their vans and their buses. Sometimes whole families or whole communities will come over to this part of Germany to help with the wine harvest. And of course, as you can imagine, it's very, 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 very strict. Very strict here. They have to start work at 6 o'clock in the morning. They're not allowed to drink any wine at all. At least not until 9 o'clock in the morning. Terribly strict. I must admit, I do enjoy the occasional glass of wine myself, purely for medicinal purposes, of course. Not everyone is aware of the medicinal properties of wine, you know, but you know what they say, that red wine is good for the heart, and it calms you down. And I do tend to get a little bit excitable from time to time. So I find that a glass of red wine does me good. Jill, on the other hand, she prefers white wine. She finds that it energizes her and makes her more sociable, and she is a bit of a party girl sometimes too, so she enjoys the occasional glass of white wine. Whereas, according to my notes, champagne encourages us to action. It does not stipulate what kind of action, but if it's action that you need, champagne is apparently what you should drink. Now then, I know, you've heard in a northerly direction, following the border between France and Germany. For a while it flows exclusively into Germany before moving once again in a westerly direction, into Holland, where with other rivers it forms the Rhine-Meuse-Scheldt-Delta and flows into the North Sea. Altogether it's 820 miles long and has an average discharge of more than 2,000 cubic meters per second. The Rhine River. I think I can safely say that you've heard quite enough of me today. I don't hear anybody protesting to the contrary. But I think you deserved a break. And I was wondering whether you'd appreciate it, whether you'd like a little bit of Black Forest folk music. What do you think? Yes, a little bit of Black Forest. I won't put it on too loudly. We don't want to wake anybody up. But a little bit of Black Forest folk music. And I'll have a chat with you once again when we get back to Breisach. And it'll be time then for your morning quiz question. So that... So let's...